My name is Jos de Koning. I'm from the Netherlands, from the Vrije Universiteit Amsterdam. Good. I worked there since something like 86 or so. I've been a couple of years away from Amsterdam. At that time, I worked at the University of Calgary in Canada. I worked a lot with Gerrit-Jan van Inge-Schenau. He's one of the giants on which shoulders I can step. And on the other end, I work currently, my main collaborator is Carl Foster from the University of Wisconsin in La Crosse. Far away, as you probably know, Gerrit-Jan van Inge-Schenau already died 20 years ago, so he's far, far away. But Carl is living in the States, and we have almost a daily contact by internet, so we're working continuously on different projects. We are not funded by skating organizations. We are just funded by the university, so our research is independent and is not paid by, for instance, the Dutch government or by the Dutch, actually the government. The government is paying the universities, of course. But for that, we had to do a lot of teaching. My main workload is about teaching. I'm a skater myself. I once tried to become an Olympic athlete myself. I've seen in 1980 Erik Heiden winning 5 gold medals. I thought, well, I can do that myself as well. So I had a plan. I want to become a star at the Olympics. But then I think it was somewhere in already 81 or 82, I realized I missed something. And Carl Foster always said to me, Jos, you're missing loft. I said, what? You have the loft syndrome. And I said, well, loft syndrome, what's that? He said, well, it's the lack of fucking talent. So, and he's always quite direct to me, and that's good because that keeps you sharp. Then I started to become a PhD student together with Gerrit-Jan van Inge-Schenau, and actually I ended up at the Olympics in 88. In 88 I had a research project. We did a film analysis, and we redid that in 94 in Lillehammer, and even in 2002 we had a research project in Salt Lake City. So I've been there, not as an athlete, but just as a scientist. And as a scientist, what we try to do is to answer questions. We are helpless without questions. So if we get questions, I always say, if I get an honest question, I give an honest answer. We have no secrets. I was just before the seminar, after dinner, I walked into the toilet and I came across one of the Dutch coaches, and he said, Jos, are you telling all the secrets? And I said, well, I have no secrets. If I had secrets, I was rich, because then you can sell something. I have no secrets. The only thing we can do is provide you with answers. So if you have a question, we try to answer. And one of the questions we have for years is, and from the people from practice, how do you monitor skating offside the ice? Because you are the masters on the ice. You have your stopwatch. You have your eyes. Your eyes are much better than our cameras. You see what's happening. We had to do all kinds of calculations to find out what's going on with the athlete. But you can see it. So you are the masters on the ice, and we try to be more or less the masters of the ice. And one of the most important things is that you want to have an idea about the status of your athlete. Do I train him enough? Do I train him too much? Why is one skater with one training doing different kind of things on the ice than another skater with exactly the same training? So that are difficult questions for coaches to answer. And one of the things usually happens is that you go to the laboratory. And what you usually do, or I always call it the cycle of training. You train an athlete, and finally you want to have, of course, a certain performance of the athlete, but you train him, you evaluate your training, and So you can evaluate your training just by a race. So you have done a couple of weeks training, you do a race, and out of the outcome of the race, you get an idea, well, if the training works or not. Well, in many cases, a race is not the right measure, because on a race, it's a direct measure, but there are a lot of things you can't measure during a race. So sometimes you want to measure. Well, you can do a measurement on the ice, or you can take your athlete to the laboratory and do the test over there. But what is the value of these measurements? Often I get people on the telephone and they said, well, Jos, or on mail, can we do a test in your laboratory? I said, well, what do you want to know? Because if you test something, or if you test an athlete, you have to have a question about what you want to know. If you have just one VO2 max value, for instance, what is the value of just one value, one VO2 max value? You have to have a series of them, or how this VO2 max is changing during training. So just bringing somebody to the laboratory and do a certain test, I think it's worthless. It brings in money, but it's not helpful. It costs you money. So you have to have a plan. Finally, you want to have a success, and you have to do things that are right for the athlete, right for your bank account, and right for the success of your sport. So you, how do you evaluate training? First, I want to talk about the criteria for evaluation and testing. Then I want to tell something about the aerobic system, on the criteria for the anaerobic system, a little bit about concurrent training, and about the training distribution. If you do testing, you can do tests in the field, and you can do tests in the laboratory. Well, often the tests in the field are very complex. So you have to, they are complex, but they are specific. If you bring the athlete to the laboratory, they are non-specific, but they are relatively easy, because it's easy to test somebody in a laboratory. So you always have to have a feel, well, do I need to be in a lab, or do I be on the ice? But if you want to do a VO2 max test on the ice, you need specific equipment. It's always difficult to do. In the laboratory, it's way, way easier. But it's not specific. The criteria for testing. First of all, there had to be a significant correlation between what you test and performance. If you test on something and it has no correlation with performance, I think it has no value. So if we design a test, if you look to a certain parameter, the first thing you have to think of is there a correlation between what you test and your skating performance? The second thing is, do the test results reflect seasonal progression? If you test something, for instance VO2 max, and you train yourself like hell the whole winter or the whole summer, and the parameter that didn't change, what is the value for that parameter? So if you look at something, it had to change by the amount of training, because if the athlete has invested 100 hours and it has not changed, then it has no value as well. The third thing is, there had to be a sound physiological interpretation of your test results, so that it results in that it translates into training. So if I measure something, you can say, well, if you have a high value or a low value, if you do this or this or this, then it will change into a higher value. So you can use your test results for your training plan. So these are the three cornerstones for testing your athletes. This is true for in the laboratory, but I think it's also true for on the ice. So what I now will do is look for these criteria for the first variable, the VO2, or the aerobic system. We all know that the aerobic system for an athlete is a very important system. So let's first look at at the physiological interpretation. Well, it is a variable parameter, and we can translate it into training. So if you do a certain amount of aerobic training, your VO2 will go up. If you skip your aerobic training, your VO2 will go down. And even if you look to certain parameters in the body, like red blood mass or whatever, it's influenced by the amount of training you do, and it will have an influence on your VO2 max. So there is a physiological interpretation. So that's right. The second point will be there is significant correlation between VO2 and your skating performance. Well, if you look for the last 60 years at the world records of the 1500 meter, well, the world record has changed for a half a minute. So incredible performance gain. What we can do is look in the literature to VO2 values of these athletes. Well, I found measurements taken from world champions in the past, in the 50s and the 60s. I found data from Russian skaters skating on the ice with a certain system with a portable Douglas bag. And when I saw these papers, I redid the experiments on the ice with a portable Douglas bag. And more recently, we did measurements on the ice for maximal oxygen uptake with automatic systems. If we take this data, so this data from the last 50 years, and you look at the maximal values, they didn't change at all. And the red dots are measurements done on the ice, and the white dots are top skaters in the laboratory. So we see a massive improvement in performance, and the VO2 max of these skaters in 50 years' time doesn't change. So is VO2 max an important parameter for top skaters? I don't think so. Although, if you look to aerobic economy, so that's the amount of oxygen you need for a kilometer of skating, then you see a certain difference. And the most important difference you see is the last couple of years, since 2000, and that's mainly contributable to the use of the clap skate. So the clap skate has improved your skating economy. It costs you less oxygen to cover a kilometer. So if we look at the if there is a significant correlation between test results and performance, it's not there. Do I say that VO2 max or training for VO2 max is not important? No, I don't say that. It's not a specific enough variable to measure in the laboratory to say something to your athlete, you're on your right way or not. It's important because you need to have a certain VO2 max to endure all your training. And later on in this talk, you will see that you need to do a certain amount of aerobic training to be able to do the hard stuff. It's a very important thing. But VO2 testing in the laboratory, I'm afraid there is not too much value to that. Let's look at if the test results fluctuate, if they reflect seasonal fluctuation, so seasonal progression. We all know that if you look at the training hours through the year, the effective training hours, just in the spring you don't do that much, and during the summer you have your peak in the hours you do, and it's even a little bit lower. If you look at the VO2 on the bicycle test, you don't see a thing. So VO2 measurements are not showing what you have done. So I think it's not reflective for seasonal progression. let's do an anaerobic test. An anaerobic test that's done very often is the 30 seconds wind gate. Who of you have done that? Yourself. It's horrible, isn't it? I even, at a certain time, I thought, well, a 30 second test is not specific enough for 1,000 meters skaters, so let's design a 60 second wind gate test. So I've even done 60 second wind gate test with skaters. They hated me. You know why. It's very hard, it's brutal. But there is a sound physiological interpretation of these results, because it tells you something about your anaerobic capacity or your peak power. So the same as with your VO2 measurements, there is a clear physiological picture you can draw. So I say, yes, it could be a failure. But then the next point is there a significant correlation between your wind gain scores and your test your performance? Recently, Nico Hoffman, he's the physio of one of the skating teams in the Netherlands, together with Jack Ory, we evaluated their wind gate tests together with the performance on the ice, and we found very strong relationships between, for women and for men, relation between the peak power at the 30 seconds test and the mean power and performance. So there's a quite strong relation between these variables. So if you get 1 watt per kg more, it directly translates into, for women, if you look at the peak power output, 0.7 seconds faster at the 1500, and for instance on the 1500 meter, if you have 1 watt per kg more and mean power, it will reflect into it will translate into almost a 2 seconds faster 1500 meter. So there is a very strong relation. So is there a correlation between your test results and performance? Yes. The next one is do the test results reflect seasonal progression? And there's a study I did almost 25 years ago. We looked at peak power and mean power during the year. And there's almost no change in power, peak power or mean power over the year. So we had to say, well, it's not that sensitive. It's there, but it's not sensitive. The last data from Hoffman and Ory show that if you gain a certain power output in the winter or in the summer, it translates to a certain gain in speed or a gain in performance during the winter time. So there is an association, but it is not that strong. So, does it reflect seasonal progression? No, but there is a little yes. Well, pretty negative, isn't it? But we all know that skaters need a high VO2. We all know that skaters need a higher anaerobic power. This is our business. This is what you do every day with them. You try to improve their aerobic metabolism. You try to improve their anaerobic metabolism. You try to improve the skating ability to translate power to speed. So training consists always of aerobic and anaerobic training. But why do we don't see it in the test results? Well, maybe there's something like concurrent training, and that is the next topic I would like to discuss with you. And here we have a very complicated graph, but I would like to explain it to you. We have done a four-year project together with Steven van der Zwaard. He's one of my PhD students, and his thesis will be defended summer this spring. So it's brand new stuff. And in that project, we looked at the influence anaerobic training has on aerobic training. Because if you do anaerobic training or weight training, what you like to do over there is you like to grow muscles. What? You want to have stronger muscles, you want to have thicker muscle fibers. Because the number of muscle fibers you have, they are constant, and by strength training you increase the size. So they get thicker, they get stronger. But if they get thicker and if they get stronger, they get more bulkier, you have more muscle mass, and your anaerobic work you can do is directly linked to body to muscle mass. So if you have more muscles, you can do more anaerobic work. So there is a clear relation between anaerobic training and weight training and the amount of anaerobic work you can do. So what you do if you do anaerobic training, you grow muscles. Your muscle fiber get thicker. And the thicker they are, the stronger they are. On the other hand, if you do endurance training, what you do with your muscles, of course, if you do endurance training, your heart get bigger. And your heart needs to get bigger because you have to pump more oxygen through your body. But the most important thing that happens is that you grow mitochondria into your muscles. And mitochondria are your energy factories. In your mitochondria, you make your ATP, your adenosine triphosphate. You need that for your muscle contraction. The more mitochondria you have, the larger your aerobic power you can generate. So the more, the better. So if I do aerobic training, I get more mitochondria. Well, this is a happy story. I get thicker muscles if I do this. I get more mitochondria if I do that. I become a better skater. But it's one part of the story. There's another part, and it says, well, as soon as I do anaerobic work, as soon as I do my weight training, I create hypoxia in my muscles that has a negative effect on my mitochondria. And simply, my body is throwing out mitochondria out of my muscles. So, if I do weight training, that will counter-affect my effects from my aerobic training. On the other hand, if I do my aerobic training, I give a signal to my muscles. Your muscle fiber need to be thinner, smaller muscle fiber. So you throw out mass and you grow smaller muscle fibers. So the result of this is, if I do one day training like this and the other way training like that, and I do that for a whole week, I exhaust my athlete, but at the end of the week, nothing gained. That's possible. So, what's the reason for that? Well, if you have a muscle fiber with a certain thickness, inside that muscle fiber you have your mitochondria built in. That mitochondria needs oxygen, and that oxygen is coming from the capillaries around the muscle fiber. If your muscle fiber gets thicker, the distance between your capillaries and your mitochondria becomes larger. So the diffusion distance becomes larger. So it becomes more difficult for oxygen to get at the mitochondria. So just a natural thing for your muscle fibers is, if you do aerobic work, that your muscle fibers need to be as small as possible. On the other hand, because if you do a lot of anaerobic work, you create hypoxia, And that hypoxia, that's something a muscle doesn't like to see. The hypoxia is caused by the mitochondria, because the mitochondria, they consume the oxygen. So a natural thing for the muscles to do, if you make them anaerobic enough, is throwing out these mitochondria. So you need to find the way of training that you grow muscles and you build in as much as possible mitochondria. And that needs to be done by a good periodization, or doing this kind of work without getting hypoxic. Sometimes I see athletes, they do training in the weight room and they almost vomit. They do a 1 minute exercise where they do as fast as possible just things that they really get hypoxic in the muscles. If I see things like that, then I will think, well, there's now one thing going on in that body. They throw away mitochondria. And you have to do a lot of aerobic training to build them in again. So sports like speed skating, like rowing, the kind of training you do over there, or the kind of type of athlete you need, is you need a powerful athlete for rowing, but also rowers, they have a high VO2 max. You need to have an aerobic monster with a high power output, right? For a skater, more or less the same. But on the other end, if you look at the VO2 max of speed skaters, just traditionally trained speed skaters, they are relatively low. If I see values above 70 millimoles per kg, that's quite rare. They're usually just below 70. I almost seen no skater in the 80s. Well, if you look at cross-country skiing or just cycling, just road cycling, above 80 is more or less a prerequisite to be in the upper league. So I think speed skating is a specific sport in the sense that there's always a kind of battle inside. Is how can we build muscles as strong as possible and as anaerobic as possible, and how can we, on the other hand, build in as much as possible mitochondria to do the aerobic work. Well, if you look to training practices, if you looked at the training zones, and the training zones are often used for monitoring of training, you can, if we make life simple, we can say, okay, we have the training zone below our first lactate threshold or ventilation threshold. We have a workload between lactate threshold 1 and lactate threshold 2, and a zone above lactate threshold 2. So this is the easy stuff. This is the really hard stuff. And there's something in between. So there are people that make even 5 zones, or I've seen 9 zones. But if you make life easy, 3 zones. And if you look at the lactate, then lactate curves get really up there. So if we take training and we look at different training models, then in the past, or still is there, you have the so-called threshold training. The threshold training, the most training is done somewhere between lactate threshold 1 and lactate threshold 2. And of course, they've done some aerobic training, there's some real hard stuff, but the most stuff is done in here. And this kind of training is the training a lot of cyclists do if they go out. It almost always end up in a kind of race. Yeah. Just easy pedaling is just training here. If we look at the idea of concurrent training, and we do trestle training, then I think we waste a lot of time, because especially in here, we try to build mitochondria and we try to build muscle, but at the same time we are getting hypoxic, so we throw out mitochondria and we have a force to make our muscles thinner. So it could be that trestle training is not the answer. Another way of training is the so-called polarized training. So a lot of training volume done at relatively low intensities, almost nothing between threshold 1 and threshold 2, and then a certain amount of work done in the highest zone. This polarized training that was analyzed by Steven Seiler from Norway. He looked at the top Norwegian skaters and skiers, and here we're talking about the real top of the world. Within this data, there are athletes that won something like 13 Olympic medals, so the real top athletes. You see a clear polarized way of training. Almost 80% of the training is done at below lactate travel. Around lactate travel, almost nothing. And something like 20% above lactate threshold. And of course, this is cross-country skiing. Cross-country skiing is different from speed skating in the sense that it takes you a longer time. It's more aerobic. But if you look at his recent data of Ori et al., what he did, he studied the training programs of the Dutch teams from the 70s till now. And he categorized all the kind of training they did. So he got the training logs of Henk Gemser, Leen Frommer, all these old coaches from the 60s, the 70s and the 80s. And they just categorized all the training, how much it was done in zone 1, 2 and 3. Zone 1 is the aerobic zone. Zone 2 is between lactate threshold 1 and 2. And zone 3 is the real hard stuff. And if you look at in the 70s, a lot of the training is done in the middle section. So this is, you can call this the threshold training plan. And if you look towards the 2010, most of the work is done in the low intensity zone and only a little bit in zone 2 and 3. And why is that? Because skating is still an anaerobic sport. I think that you need to do this to endure this, to have the benefit of this. And I even think that when skaters are entering the race season, often the amount of training in this zone goes down, and the amount of racing, that's by definition somewhere here, is going up. And if you look at the conditioning of these athletes, it's going down the tank. And one of the reasons could be that you just are destroying your mitochondria. So, if you look at on one part your anaerobic training, and another part your aerobic training, you need them both. And what you need to do is to monitor your training distribution quite precisely, because if you know what they do, and you need to do that on the ice, you need to do that on the bike or whatever, you get an idea which process is going on and how to prevent them from getting tired at the end of the week and not gaining anything. And one of the things that can help you is the system that Roy was just introducing to you. Just log all the times they skate, that you get a good idea about the intensity of the training they do. And but not only on the ice, but also all the training they do outside of the skating arena. So I think the most important message is the laboratory can be helpful. So if you look at the criteria, the laboratory can be helpful, but you always need to have in mind, is there a significant correlation between the test results and your performance? If no, then it's questionable to invest your money in that kind of testing. Are the test results of, do the test results reflect seasonal progression? If no, why are you testing anyway? And there need to be a sound physiological interpretation of your test results so that you can change your plan you have your with your athlete. And keep in mind that concurrent training for speed skating is an incredible important issue, and that you had to build your training around it so that you can grow an athlete with a high anaerobic power output and a very good aerobic power output. And I think that's not easy. Thank you very much. What I will do, I will send this presentation in PDF to the organizers, and they will distribute it to you. You always can mail me, as I said in the beginning. Every honest question gets an honest answer. Thank you very much.